But we're talking about affordable food plots for bow hunters especially. And if you can do a little food plot like this, you will be more successful. I promise you. There's so much confusion today. There's so much hype on food plots, and then there's so much confusion about what to do with food plots. What we've done here is in our little brown bags, and this is what we do. We store it just like this, enough to do quarter acre, half acre, whatever we're doing. The first thing you need to know is not just the different kinds of seed, you need to know about your soil. And you know, we got a little folder here, Michigan State University food plots. You can contact your local co-op and at Michigan State University, they have, you can go to your county at the co-op and they'll give you your little container that you put your soil in, and on that container has 100% all the instructions, everything you need to do. You do that, it's 12 bucks to get that. You get up, it tells you exactly how to do your soil samples. You get one of these, you do your soil sample accordingly, then what you do is they have a form that you fill out. It's a simple little thing. You fill this information out, you take that, mail that into them. There's all the directions and everything, how to, you know, what, it tells you actually where to mail it and everything. You can mail that into them and they'll send you back the results. And in that, they will actually inform you on what kind of fertilizer you need to be using, if you need to put lime down, you know, all those things. All that information will be provided to you, and it's $12. And then you can be doing it right. Because I can tell you, the thousands of emails we get from people that go into a store and buy a pack of seed and put it down and they don't know what they're doing. We're just going to tell you what works for us. And after 60 years, we do know what works for us. And it's all over the country, different things. I mean, you know, in the South, there's things like chufa and all chicory. Those things, chicory, that kind of stuff don't do well in Michigan. These are the things that do well in the Midwest. That's what we're trying to focus on right now. But again, the best thing you can do is to do your soil sample, contact your, you know, state university, you know, go to your county, the cooperative extension, and then go to your local feed stores and elevators and talk to those people and even talk to some of the farmers that you know that have. I'll tell you this, there are a lot of farmers that are complaining about deer destroying their crops. Those are the farmers you want to talk to and find out what they're using, because if they got a problem with deer, that's a problem you want right there. Yep. So if you are buying a seed that has all the information on the back of it and you're happy with that, you know, keep doing what you're doing. But what's happening, there's so much hype on food plots that there are people popping out of the woodwork to, you know, to make some money on a seed. And there again, you gotta be careful. You wanna buy stuff that you know is certified that will germinate. And the only way you can do that is to buy legitimate seed. So we're telling you to stay, you know, with the people that do it right. Like if you're in Northern Ohio or even Western Pennsylvania or Indiana, it's not too far for you to drive to go to a store that we recommend. That's Cutler Dickerson in Adrian, Michigan. You can call there and you can talk to those people. They really know what they're doing. They've been doing this for a lot of years and we work with those guys. And you can go in there and you can buy this seed very affordably and you can have an awesome food plot. Okay, in the Midwest, we got unpredictable weather. I mean, it's Michigan is really unpredictable weather. I mean, you might get snow in June in Michigan. You might get 80 degrees in February or March. I mean, it's all over the place, man.
November.
Yeah. I mean, it's really all over the map. So what seed to plant and when to plant it, that's all something you have to do a little bit of research on. The one thing that we know is like a clovers, your clovers, you can, in Michigan, in the Midwest, you wanna check the soil temperatures. You wanna know what your temperatures are at night. And, you know, that information is provided to you by, you know, your local grain elevators and your co-ops and all that. They'll give you that information. Or you can go online and get that information as well. We like to use a clover, and some of the things that they recommend you only plant in the fall, we plant that stuff in the spring. We want to have something going all the time for those deer
and
turkeys, because we want to keep that wildlife on our property. So we do put in clover in the spring, and sometimes we put clover in the fall. Sometimes you have to put in, like, we don't have it up here, but alfalfa is something that I recommend. If you're going to plant alfalfa, you want to plant a cover crop with that, a seed that it can grow up inside. Like, you might even want to put corn or beans and put clover in with that, or alfalfa in with that. But alfalfa is something you have to maintain those fields. You want to mow it. You want to mow it, you know, when it's required. You might get 1, 2, 3 cuttings off that field. And then what are you going to do with the hay when you mow it? You either have somebody come in there with a baler and do that, or you're going to have to mow it and rake it and take it off that field, or it'll lay on the field and it'll die. So you don't want that to happen. Now, one of the things that we like to do, some of the seeds that we plant in the fall or in late summer, we let them grow, let them go all the way through the winter, and then we don't touch that field in the spring. We let those seeds come back again, and they'll reseed. And a lot of the stuff gets tall, and it'll get ahead on it. And turkeys, man, they love that. Deer won't. The deer stay away from those fields, but the turkeys like it. So clovers, it's recommended that you plant clover, depending on the state that you're in. It's usually a spring planting seed. Purple top turnips, I like to plant those late in August in Michigan or in the Midwest. Late in August, September, you can plant it a lot later than that. But we want it to, you know, the thing about turnips, it depends how big you want the turnips, you know, during the season that you're going to be in there on those fields. A lot of times, deer know to pull those turnips and radishes out of the ground, and they'll lay on top of the ground, and then they can come back and feed on those once the ground freezes too hard to dig those up. So a turnip is something that does well in cold weather, and after the frost, the tops of these things get really sweet and the deer really like them.
So if you're going to plant the turnip, that's more something that you would maybe plant with the idea of maybe hunting that in November and December.
Right.
In the Midwest.
Well,
you wouldn't want to plant turnips and really try to hunt it heavy like the first week of October.
Right. Frost creates a sweet taste in turnips, in the green and in the turnip. Then buckwheat, that is something that you can plant in warmer weather. You can plant that in the spring. You can plant it in the fall. Anything that you plant in the spring is going to have, you know, the summer to come up. But a lot of times when you plant, like we're jumping all over, but it's important to do this. If you plant rye in the spring, it'll do good for 6 to 8 weeks after it comes up, and then the deer will have it all mowed off. So you're going to have to plant it again in the fall, which if you don't have a problem with that, that's great. But buckwheat, it gets tall, and it really is an attraction for especially whitetail. You can do that spring, midsummer. Again, check in your area with the local feed stores and co-ops and all the people that you need to talk to. This right here is a very inexpensive seed. It's very affordable, and we really like field rye. We put this in most of our test plots. We have some field rye going in there because it germinates so fast, it's so hardy. And you can see right now in our food plot, we got field rye in there, and the deer are still coming in there, and they're still nipping the tops of that stuff off. I mean, they'll keep coming and coming and coming until they're right down to the dirt.
And
like it's very inexpensive.
Like we're getting ready to say in a future segment in this video, we have proof on camera and on trail camera of bucks walking across the turnip and across the radish to get to the field rye. Not even paying attention to the turnip or the radish, walking right across it to get to the field rye.
Large white radishes. Right now there's a craze on the radishes. I mean, everybody is talking about radishes. They're awesome. Farmers use radishes, you know, they put them in as an ag product and then go in there and turn the soil and use that, you know, for fertilizer as well. Radishes are awesome. I mean, the deer really like them. Deer really are unpredictable. I mean, anybody that says they're an expert, they know everything about deer. I've been around deer every single day of my life, and I still am amazed at what I see these deer doing. And, you know, we're talking about putting in these food plots and creating staging areas and all that. Like that really good buck that Guy killed, he stayed in that staging area, and he was totally content that all those other deer were out there eating ahead of him. He didn't worry about that. He was just making sure that, you know, he had his harem of does still. It doesn't matter, you know, that bucks go into, you know, the bachelor groups. They still are aware that does are a different sex than them. The most important thing is put your food plot in an area where you got good heavy cover around it and where you have water. If you have heavy cover and water and a variety of food plots, it's like us when we go to a buffet. Most people like buffets because you can pick and choose what you want and you don't have to eat it if you don't like it. And that's the same way deer are. They like to meander around and just browse. I mean, there are days when deer would prefer eating bark off of a branch than eating any of this plush, awesome food. So you just have to keep all that in mind, and you really have to do a lot of homework, a lot of test plots, and keep records.
And stay out of the woods unless you absolutely have to go in to plant, to hunt, whatever, but don't just hang out in the woods all the time.
Yeah.
That'll keep your deer on your property if you leave them alone.
Well, there's something I want to point out. You know, if you have your seed, you can store it in 10 cans, or you can store it in a 55-gallon or 5-gallon, whatever, steel barrels. We always use fresh cab. We use this stuff religiously. I got storage barns out here that are full of seed and bags and all that stuff, and we don't have a problem. If you're not going to have any water supply, you got to deal with that. And what we do where we don't have water, we have 250, 275-gallon totes that we put on a trailer with a pump, and we actually go out there and we actually spray these fields and make sure that you want to make sure that you got moisture to get that seed to germinate. You know, how much seed to put per acre? Some people think more is better. Maybe, maybe not. You can put too much seed in there and you will choke out, you know, each individual type of seed. So you want to be careful with that. And I've tried some of that stuff that you just throw it in a pile of leaves or throw it in the woods or whatever. I've done all that. I'm telling you, what works best is to get a good seed bed. If you have vegetation, you don't want to just throw that seed in that vegetation. You don't even want to try to no-till if you got heavy vegetation, sod. The best thing to do with that is to plow it with a plow. Turn it over, get that soil from 8 to 10 to 12 inches below that sod, flip it over, and then go in there with a disc and work that and get a good seed bed. We do not want to put our seed in real fluffy, soft soil. We want a good, firm, well-prepared soil seed bed to put that seed in, and then you can go over with a color packer or you can drag it with a fence. I'm going to tell you, if you drag your seed with a fence or anything like that, just know that your seed is going to come up looking like you drug it with a fence. I mean, you're going to drag seed and it's going to spread out and it's going to be very inconsistent. The best way to do that is to, and this is what we use. We use one of these hand cranks. I mean, I can plant with this thing right here, I can plant 5 acres, no problem. We do it all the time. I mean, we use this for fertilizer. We actually, a fertilizer that we use right here is Herbrook's organic chicken manure. We use that for fertilizer. Be careful, this stuff is really hot. You wanna know what you're doing when you use this fertilizer, and sometimes we'll put a light coat down, then we'll disc that down, and we'll let that set for, you know, a few days, and then we'll go back in there and do our seed. But this thing turns, it's got a little trigger on the side here. It gives you the exact amount that, I mean, you can watch and see how much you're covering, but this does a perfectly even job. And then if you can get yourself, and you can go to an auction. I mean, we're hooked up with all the auctioneers. We go to a lot of these auctions and buy these farm tractors and, you know, stuff like this. This is a tractor we use right here to put in a food plot this past spring. I mean, this thing does an awesome job. Here, let's show what the seeds look like. All right, your clover, you can see this is really, really fine. It looks like, it almost looks like fertilizer. God is awesome, making a little bitty pinpoint size seed turn into a plant. You know, the Bible talks about if you have faith the size of a mustard seed, and mustard seed is really small, it's like turnip. Then you got purple top turnip, same thing. I mean, that's small seed. So if you have a seeder, like a tractor, you know, with a three-point hit seeder, or you pull it with a four-wheeler or whatever, you want to make sure that you set that thing exactly the way they tell you to set it. Well, otherwise, you're going to go through 100 pounds of seed in 50 feet.
That's why we recommend a hand spreader, yeah, because of the fineness of the seed.
What we're talking about, folks, is putting in a good food plot affordably. All of the seeds that you see right here, yeah, are all really, really affordable. You can put in a quarter acre food plot for $15. I mean,
wow.
Buckwheat, that's a little larger seed. Now, the thing about buckwheat that we like, it gets really tall, like a kind of like a sorghum. It gets up, you know, where deer can actually go in there and bed in this stuff. That's another thing to consider when you're doing a food plot around the edges. I would recommend, and we don't have it out here, but any kind of a sorghum or anything like that, if it grows in your area, that stuff gets really tall, like a swamp grass. And deer like that because they can bed in that. And a good thing about that is you can build a, you know, a barrier with that and put that around your blinds, and it actually is a natural cover. Or you can actually just put a clump of that stuff in there and you can get in it and hunt out of it. Then we go to the field rye. This looks like oats that you might see that you feed horses. It has that oat looking texture.
Tilt your hands working.
This right here is an awesome product. I mean, even if you're gonna put in these kind of food plots, I recommend you do a 10-foot, 12-foot swath of this all the way around the perimeter of that thing. I mean, if you plant your food plots in rows, or if you go in there and you go around the perimeter with, you know, a field rye, then you do a little bit of turnips in there and a little bit of this, you know, mix it up so you have a variety in there. You create a buffet. Otherwise, you need to go in and do a quarter acre here, go 100 yards away, do another quarter acre, and make sure you have good cover between those food plots, because those deer will hop into that cover and they'll sneak through there and get to that next one. And that's where you want to put your stand. Most of the time, we have our stands off of the food plot and just into the cover. Not in the bedding area, but in the staging areas. So then the last one is these radishes. Here's what that looks like. See it? Now, you know, if you don't have one of these little seeders right here, you can actually take this stuff by hand. And as a kid, we did it like that. Just take the bag in your hand like that and just sling your hand like that and watch the seed where it goes on the ground.
Or put it in a little cup.
Yeah, but your hand really works good for a small food plot. You'll have success. Yes. There are million-dollar tractors with million-dollar implements that you can get that put this down perfect. And their tractors today actually have computers on them that know exactly how much to plant, where to plant, and does all that stuff for you. But we're talking about affordable food plots for bow hunters especially. And if you can do a little food plot like this, you will be more successful, I promise you.